Welcome back to When Harry Met Board Games, where we feed our people with relatable content and our victory condition is your satisfaction. I'm Harry and today we have another top 10 list for you all. Today I'll be covering my top 10 board games from the year 2008. And over the course of this year, I have done many similar videos where I have focused on a year or a range of years and have covered my favorite games that have fallen within that time period. And today I'll be covering the year 2008, which I do think is an excellent game. An excellent year, I should say. There are a few titles that came out in 2008 that I've yet to play that I'm really intrigued about. But based on the games that I have covered and that I have played within this year, I have come up with this particular list of my 10 favorite games from this year, 2008. So without any further ado, let's get straight to the list. My number 10 board game from the year 2008 is Celtis. Designed by Reiner Knizia, published by Cosmos Games. This is the 2008 Spiel des Jahres winner, the one and only time that Reiner Knizia was able to capture that illustrious, prestigious award. And this is basically Lost Cities, the board game, which it has been rebranded in other parts of the world as Lost Cities, the board game, for those who are familiar with the classic card game. And basically what it does, it gives you a board, which is nothing more than an abstracted five rows that represent paths that you're trying to advance in. And basically, when you play down these numbered cards, they allow you to advance up these respective tracks, and you score certain points based on how far you progress in each of these. And along the way, you're unlocking certain tiles that either give you some gems or stones, which are a set collection that scores you points exponentially at the end of the game, or some of them just score you immediate points right then and there, or some of them allow you or grant you the right to move any one of your pieces up one of the paths, right? But you have to be careful because once you start on a certain path, you are liable to suffer negative points if you don't make it far enough on that track. So you may not want to advance on all five tracks if you cannot. And each of the tracks corresponds with one of the five different colors in the deck of cards. And the deck of cards each have cards numbering from 0 to 10, and there's two copies of each number. Now, the interesting twist on this over Lost Cities is that in Lost Cities, you must play cards in ascending order. So once you play down a 2, the next card has to be higher than a 2, and so on and so forth. Also, in Lost Cities, there's only one copy of each number. So the fact that you have two copies of each number allow you to theoretically place a second card of the same number. So for example, if you do play a 2, you could play a 2 right afterward. But another neat thing about this game is that you can start in descending order. So based on what you drew in your opening hand and what have you, you can decide to go in ascending order or descending order in each of the respective colors. So instead of starting with like a 2, let's say, you could start with a 9 and then work your way down. Now, once you've committed the direction in which you're going, whether it's ascending or descending, you are committed to that direction and you must keep on going that way throughout the rest of the game. But it's really cool because even once you get, let's say once you've ultimately, you've made it as far as you can in one of the paths and you still have cards to play in that color, you could always keep on advancing that color theoretically to allow you the right to move another colored path. So there's a lot of cool little neat things, very, very abstracted, but it's very beautiful. I love the green board. It just jumps out at you. And yeah, this is my number 10 board game from the year 2008, Celtis. Now let's move on to my number 9. And my number 9 game is actually Time's Up Title Recall. I know, a party game. And since I've noticed that most of my subscribers loathe party games, I will not belabor the point, but simply put, this is like charades with levels of progression because you've got 3 rounds and ultimately by the final round, you will not be able to do anything other than mime your situation or charades, you know, basically role play and move and gesture in order to get people to guess what you're doing, right? But early on in the earlier rounds, there is some use of words. And it's really cool because players after the first round will read all the cards that are available, all the different titles, because this is based on movie, books, and song titles. And you will, if you have really good memory or you have decent memory, you should have most of those answers in the back of your mind so that when you see them acted out, they'll jump to you a little bit quicker. But it's nice, silly fun, fun team versus team type of game. My number nine game from 2008, Time's Up Title Recall. And folks, that I promise that's the last party game for today, unless you consider my number eight to be a party game, and that is Formula D. And this here is a reprint of a much older game that actually came out in the early 1990s, Formula D. But this reprint here is from Asmodee. And from what I know, this is basically the same, more or less, as the original. I don't know if any changes as far as the rules are concerned, any streamlining that may have taken place. You might correct me. I think perhaps the aesthetic of it has improved, and they've added a different street racing module. So you have a reverse side of the board, which is not only a different type of map for players to race through, but it actually comes with different types of rules to govern your racing, right? This game is cool because players are basically taking the control of one of the car, and they're rolling dice, and there's six different types of dice representing or corresponding with the six different gears. You have a four-sided dice and a six-sided dice and an eight-sided dice and a 10-sided dice and a 20-sided dice, and they have different ranges of numbers that players have to understand and speculate the probabilities as to what can be rolled with each of the respective gears. And each turn, you can increase your gear up by one, or you can decrease your gear down by one. Theoretically, you can decrease more than one if you're willing to take damage points or wear points on your vehicle, and your vehicle only starts with 18 wear points. And along the game, as you are forced to brake and colliding with other players potentially and having all sorts of engine malfunctions, you're going to take wear points to your vehicle, and it will theoretically dwindle down. And if it ever gets down to zero, you are eliminated from the race no matter how good you're doing. So this is one of those games where you want to count the costs. So things like the corners where you turn here, you got to be really, really careful manipulating those things, because in particular, they always have a limit as to how many times your vehicle is required to stop within that specific part of the board. And if your vehicle doesn't meet that requirement, they're going to take wear points, right? And in certain cases, they might even actually just die altogether if they don't meet any of the requirements for those stops right there. It's a really cool game. It is a little bit long for a racing game, but it's fun. It's exciting. There's lots of moments for laugh out loud, exciting, cheering on people, booing people kind of things. Lots of fun, excitement, and a lot of opportunities for catch up in this game. If you fall behind, you can do some risk taking and perhaps maybe catch up to those who are in the lead. My number eight board game from the year 2008, Formula D. And now we move on to my number seven. And my number seven is Roll Through the Ages, designed by Matt Leacock and published by Eagle Griffin Games. This is such a cool little roll and write before it was known as such. And at a time where roll and writes were not that popular, I can only think of a few games, perhaps. Off the top of my head, I think the Catan, the dice game, might have been around at this time. But there's not too many. Obviously, Yahtzee and things like that have existed for decades. But this game is really, really cool. You are rolling the dice very much Yahtzee style with the ability to re-roll. And there's so many aspects of this game that I think are very cool. It's very abstracted because your paper is literally just this right here, which has, boxes to check off and circle, and again, boxes here to check off and boxes to check off. And then finally you write numbers, you tabulate all your different scores. So from that perspective, very, very abstracted and very plain. But the board, I think, is so cool because basically you have these wooden boards here, and you have these different pegs that you use to keep track of your different resources. And there's five different resources in this game: wood, stone, clay, weapons, and so on and so forth. And you also got food, actually, as a sixth resource, because you have to feed your people. The bigger your civilization gets, your cities get, because this is a civilization game, the more food you have to provide to meet those civilizations. Now, of course, the bigger your cities get also means the more of these nice chunky wooden dice that you roll, and the different faces of the die tell you what you can get, right? Now, again, this game is really, really cool because I find that this wooden pegboard here really brings you into this theme, because this is basically Roll Through the Ages, the Bronze Age. So, you know, we're talking about 4,000 years ago or so. And the components actually bring you into that time because you feel like you're playing a game from a, again, from a component perspective that was invented in the Bronze Age. And for some people, that may be like, that might not be as interesting. That may be like, oh, that's so boring. You know, all the modern, beautiful components that exist nowadays. But I think that it actually makes me get more into the theme. My number 8 or 7 board game from 2008, Roll Through the Ages. And now we move on to my number 7. And my number 7 is A Castle for All Seasons. And this is designed by Inca and Marcus Brand and published by Rio Grande Games. The artwork is designed by renowned, prestigious artist, Michael Menzel. And this game here, actually, I find that it's a response to Pillars of the Earth, which actually came out just 1 year before and was very successful. And the reason why is because, first of all, the title and the theme here kind of reminds and alludes to Pillars of the Earth. You, in Pillars of the Earth, you're constructing the pillars. You're constructing a cathedral, and it's based on a novel, right? Ken Follett's novel. And here, this is not based on any IP or any literature, but what happens in this game is you're constructing a castle that's ready for all seasons. And basically, again, the theme feels very similar. The mechanisms feel very similar because what you have is, first of all, you have this beautiful board designed by Michael Menzel, who also made the board for Pillars of the Earth. But also you have these different resources, which include many of the resources from Pillars of the Earth, like wood and stone. Wood and stone are in this game. You also have clay, you have straw, I believe it is, and you have silver here as a wild card. And then you have worker placement. And back in 2008, worker placement was not as ubiquitous as it is today, right? It was something that was still growing as a genre. And Pillars of the Earth was very influential towards that. And in this game, you have these worker placement spots. So you're using your resources here. You're doing a variable phase order at the beginning of each round. Simultaneously, players choose a character. And then you activate those characters in sequential order. There's a numbered order in which they're activated. And these cards basically grant you different powers. They either give you money, or they give you resources, or they give you the ability to build a building. And depending on the worker that you choose for these cards here, these characters, you can either build for a full value of the victory points that the building would get grant you, or you can build the building for half of its victory points, or you can build the building and instead of getting paid in victory points, you get paid in coins and money, which in this game, money is very valuable. Because what happens is your worker placement spots are not taken for granted. Each worker placement spot has a circle and it has a number inside of it, which is how many coins you need to pay in order to place a worker there. So they're not for free. So first of all, until you build some of these buildings, these because they're all going to have these little boards, these building boards laid over them. Until you build these buildings, these worker placement spots are not available. And even once they're available, you need to pay your money in order to do that, right? And you cannot put two of your workers in the same location on the same round. So you would have to wait to a future round. So theoretically, your opponents have the ability to, you know, go to that spot until you place your second one and block them off, let's say. And each of these buildings usually, not each of them, but most of them have two or three spots for their worker placement spots. But sometimes it's incremental as far as how much money you have to pay for this. So there's a lot of things to manage. I will say this, I don't like this as much as I do like Pillars of the Earth, but it does have some neat concepts. Again, resource management, worker placement, but not free worker placement because you need to pay the money. And the idea of the variable phase order with the different characters. I find all of those things to be very, very neat. And that's why this is my number 6 board game from 2008. And that is A Castle for All Seasons. And now we move on to the top 5, the cream of the crop, as I usually say. My number five board game from the year 2008 is a Game of Thrones, the card game, the living card game designed by Eric Lang and Nate French, the king and master of the living card game. This is a cool 2-4 player living card game. Usually these LCGs tend to be a 2-player experience, or maybe a cooperative experience, or maybe a team versus team type of experience. But in this game, you have 2-4 players, every man or every woman for himself or herself, and each player controls a different house of Westeros, right? And you have, in this base game, you have all of the different factions, right? You have the Lannisters, and you have the Starks, and all the different houses that you could think of are all here, right? With some basic content as you buy expansions and boosters, well, not boosters, but just expansions to this game, you gain more and more content as the game progresses. But this game is really cool because players are tactically making decisions in response to their opponents. And each round, first of all, you draft a plot card, and each house has their, you know, predetermined plot deck that you shuffle, and you draw one card per turn. And that plot deck, it's going to tell you how much money you have available for that turn, so you don't always have the same amount of money. It's going to tell you who goes first in the turn order out of all the players playing, so it's not always going to be the same turn order. And it's also going to determine some special rules or benefits for you during that round. Then you're going to be deploying your different character cards. And as you deploy your character cards, you're going to engage in conflict. And there's three spheres of conflict in this game. You have war or military, you have intrigue, and you have power. And each of these spheres gives you different benefits that you cash in whenever you win a conflict in them. And what's interesting is, all the characters, no matter how good they are, at most, they will be useful to you in two out of those three spheres. They're not going to all be useful in three. And most of them will only be useful in one out of those three spheres. So you're making your decisions. You're rotating these cards, tapping them to indicate that you're using them. Your opponents are deciding which characters they're going to use to block. And then you're resolving the conflict. And again, like in many of these games, it's about anticipating, looking at your players, your opponent's tableaus, anticipating what you think they might do, what they will defend with, what they won't. Sometimes you're very pleasantly surprised or very disappointed when you see that they react or respond differently than what you had planned. Really, really cool, really fun. Again, if you like the Game of Thrones IP, this is a good game for you to get. My number five board game from 2008, A Game of Thrones, the card game. And now we move on to my number four. My number four, for many people, will be their number one, and that is Pandemic. Again, another game designed by Matt Leacock. He had a really good year this year. And published by Z-Man Games. This is a very popular, quintessential cooperative game, if you will, very relevant to this year, 2021, the pandemic that we are living through. And in this game, basically players take on the role of a team of different members of the CDC, the Center of Disease Control. And you can be a quarantine specialist or contingency planner, or you can be a scientist or what have you. And you're all traveling through the world. The game consists of a map of the world, and you're going to different cities and you're treating the diseases, the viruses that are in there. And there's color coded respective viruses to the different regions of the world. And there's four viruses in the base game. You could add a fifth virus with the expansion, the On the Brink expansion. And basically what happens is players are trying to hold back the viruses in order to buy the CDC or themselves the time to find the cure for all these viruses, because players win as soon as they've cured all of the viruses. And to cure the viruses, you need to turn in five cards matching the color of that virus. And it takes time acquiring those cards. And you're using your team building skills, and you're mapping out the puzzle, and you're calculating what's going to come along from the infection deck, which is the equivalent of a threat deck, which basically determines which locations are going to get infected with disease at the end of each round. And you're managing all these things. And when you think you're making progress, you get epidemic cards that throw a monkey wrench, make more infection come out, sometimes quite often lead to outbreaks. And outbreaks, if you have too many of them, is one of the ways you lose the game. So you're managing all this stuff and at the same time working towards the objective of finding the cures. But you can't just focus completely on finding the cures, because if you do, then the viruses will overwhelm the world. So finding that balance, is always very interesting. There's varying levels of difficulty. You add additional epidemic cards. So much great expansion content for this game. I've played the On the Brink expansion. I played the In the Lab expansion. I played all the modules in these expansions. And there's some really, really good stuff from solo to team play to one versus all with the bio terrorists to different viruses that mutate and change as the game progresses. Really, really fun game. My number four board game from 2008, Pandemic. And now we move on to the top three. And these are amazing games. And it was really, really hard putting my number three as low as number three because I do love this game. My number three game from 2008 is Dominion. And here I have most of the content I'm using right now in the Seaside expansion here. This is a great game. This is a deck builder to the father or grandfather of all deck builders. Designed by Donald X Vaccarino and published by Rio Grande Games. This game is not the most thematic game. It's not the most aesthetically pleasing game, but it's such a fun deck builder with such a simple way of playing and such a quick way of playing because unlike most deck builders that are very tactical and reactionary, and you have this ever-changing trade market or trade row that you are interacting with, here you always have 10 kingdom cards that are always available, and they're basically your action cards. You have three or more treasure cards, and that's your money. And you have three or more victory point cards, which are the way that you score your points. And they're always there on the board. And yes, they can run out, but you know that they're there otherwise. So you can map out your turn, your next turn, as soon as you're done with your previous turn. Now, there is the occasional situation in which an opponent's decision or opponent's decisions might change what you had in mind. But even so, you should definitely have at least a backup plan. There's no need to think of too many alternatives, right? So this is really, really cool. So this tends to play very, very quickly. As a matter of fact, I find that if you do not play with attack cards, you can finish this game under 30 minutes pretty much every time. I do play occasionally with attack cards because I do like using my content. But for the most part, I actually keep attack cards out of it because it's such a smooth experience, such a smooth engine building experience as you play this game without attack cards. And it's so quick. I always play this game like twice in a row, if not three times in a row, because of how quick it plays. And there's so much content, so much variety. And the way you're trying to, as soon as you see the kingdom cards available to you, you try to figure out the three or four that you really want to focus on, that you feel like combine best with each other and will lead you in the direction that you are aiming for. Such a fun, rich experience. My number three board game from 2008, Dominion. And now we move on to my number two. And my number two board game from 2008 is Le Havre, designed by Uwe Rosenberg and published by Lookout Games. This is an absolutely phenomenal, wonderful worker placement game. And some people might not want to consider it worker placement because you only have one worker, but it's absolutely worker placement because you place your worker on a spot and that spot is not available to your opponents until you get out of there. And it's very interesting because the way the system works, unlike most worker placement games, you don't just place your workers and grab them at the end of the round. No, your worker stays there until you move him again, until you choose another worker placement action, because you don't necessarily do worker placement on each of your turns. You might choose to grab a bunch of resources that are on the offer spaces in the board, and there's a ton of resources in this game. So whenever you do make another worker placement action, you're required to move your worker. So you cannot benefit off the same action twice in a row. So even that becomes part of the strategy. And basically, you're placing your worker on different buildings, and the buildings can be in one of three locations. They could either be in your part of the city, your tableau, or they can be in the general neutral part of the city, or they can be in one of your opponent's part of the cities. And chances are, if you're going to your opponent's, definitely, and even in the neutral city buildings, you're going to have to pay some type of resource or money in order to benefit off those buildings. But your buildings that are in your city are always free to you. And if anybody comes to your buildings, they would have to pay you. And you're managing all these things in the efforts of resource acquisition and resource conversion, right? Because you want to upgrade your resources. Because all the different resources in this game, which you have wood, we have clay, we have iron, we have grain, we have fish, we have cattle, we have coal. all these different resources have upgraded versions of themselves. So sometimes your buildings and your actions allow you to gain resources. Sometimes they allow you to convert resources into an upgraded form of themselves. And also you're acquiring ships along the way and different varying levels of ships with different capacities. And these ships allow you to make shipping sales. And that's where a lot of the victory points come in, because your victory points are your money. So you're using your money to acquire things, but at the end of the game, your victory points are your money. And the buildings that you buy or that you build are also going to contribute to your victory points at the end of the game. So you're managing all this stuff, trying to get the right resources in order to get the right buildings, trying to upgrade your ships and optimize your shipments of different goods in order to acquire as much money as possible. And it's so cool because each round consists of seven collective turns amongst the players, which is why you really want to play this game with 2 to 3 players. Because once you play with 4 or 5, which the game does, not only does the game become very long, but also you have turns or rounds where you only have one action. When you play with 2 to 3 players, you're guaranteed to have at least 2 to 3 actions every round. And you want those actions because at the end of the round, you are held accountable for your workers and you need to feed them. And each round, no matter what you've done, no matter how successful you've been or how much of a failure you've been, each round you need to pay much more food than the previous round. Backing all these things in can be very challenging if you only have 2 or 3 actions. So imagine if you had less. Really cool game, really fun. If you like resource management, you like worker placement, if you like these concepts, this is a game for you. My number 2 board game from the year 2008, La Havre. And now, finally, we move on to my number 1, The King of the Hill, and that is Cosmic Encounter. And this here, folks, this game is originally designed in 1976, I believe, if I'm not mistaken. 1977, maybe. Late 1970s. And it's had so many iterations through so many different publishers. I think Mayfair had it. I think Avalon Hill had it. I think Eon Games might have been the first one. All these different publishers have had their hands on Cosmic Encounter. But this right here, the Fantasy Flight Edition, came out in the year 2008. And it is the definitive version, the definitive edition. Till this day, we're talking about 12 years later, Cosmic Encounter still calls Fantasy Flight home, which is the longest stretch, if I'm not mistaken, that this game has had with a publisher consistently putting it in print. I'm not counting years between a new publisher picking it up and the game being out of print. That doesn't count. Consistently, this game has been in print for the last 12 years under the same publisher. So, and they even came out with the 42nd anniversary edition not too long ago. So that's enough for my defense as to why this game makes it to this list, the 2008 list. Now let's talk a little about the game. This is a science fiction game, politically themed game, where players each take on an alien race with special powers, special abilities that differentiate them from all the other players around the board, around the table. And you have your own system of planets representing your little empire within the galaxy, and you're interacting or encountering all these different alien races around you. And sometimes you're engaging in negotiations in order to peacefully exchange a presence, have a colony in one of their planets, and allow them to maybe have a planet in one of your planets. But sometimes people are not as diplomatic as you would like them to be, and that leads to confrontation and conflict and war. And basically, players determine alliances. There's an attacking player, a defending player. All the players around either choose to ally themselves with the attacker or with the defender, or maybe just to bow out and watch as things unfold. And there are benefits from both sides, to be the helping the attacker or the defender. And basically, players are playing down cards, which are numbered. And they're numbered anywhere from 0 to 40. The higher numbers are rarer. The lower numbers are more common. And you reveal, and whoever has the highest attack value based on a comparison of the numbers of the cards they played plus any additional ships that were involved on their side of the conflict. And that determines who's the winner. And you resolve accordingly. Dead ships go to the warp, but there are ways of retrieving them. So many cool things going on. So much variety with all the different expansion content and all the aliens involved. So much cool opportunities for social interaction. And it's a game where you feel involved because technically you are involved on everybody's turn. And one of the neatest things about this game is that you only need, in theory, one loser. So theoretically, you can have multiple winners in this game. So it leads to a very positive outcome where several people sometimes are feeling very good about themselves because they were on the victorious side. And also, mind you, one thing that's really cool about this game is that it has a destiny deck that determines which players are going to encounter each other from round to round. That way, it prevents or discourages the idea of bullying or ganging up on people and pushing them around, right? Because you cannot just go and mess with whoever you want. Destiny will determine who you interact with. Really cool. My number one game from the year 2008, Cosmic Encounter. And that's it, folks. Those are my top 10 games from the year 2008. Comment down below. Tell me what you think about this list. What's your favorite game from the year 2008? Very interested in reading what you guys have to say. This is Harry from When Harry Met Board Games saying take care, everybody. Stay safe, stay healthy, and have fun gaming. Bye-bye.